6 meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is taking a decision on taking business in private. We have to consider whether to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Item 3 is to consider the evidence we will hear today on the biodiversity delivery plan. Item 4 is to consider a list of candidates for the appointment to the role of committee advisor. And item 5 is to consider the list of recommended candidates for appointment to the Scottish Land Commission. Do we agree to take these items in private? We are agreed. We also have to make a decision on whether, in context of our work programme at future meetings, whether we take that in private. Are we agreed that we should do? Yes, I'm seeing that's agreed. So our next item of business is an evidence session on the draft strategy plan to accompany the Scottish Government's new biodiversity strategy. The committee has continuing work we started last autumn when we took evidence on the draft strategy. It is clear that the practical delivery of the strategy was going to be crucial, and this session is about that new draft strategy. Today we have a panel of experts on marine biodiversity to share their views on the draft, and we will discuss the terrestrial aspects of the plan early in the new year. This morning, I'm very pleased to welcome Claire Cavers, Senior Projects Manager for FIDRA, Callum Duncan, the Head of Conservation for Scotland Marine Conservation Society, Elspeth MacDonald, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, gosh, that proved a bit difficult, Tavish Scott, the Chief Executive of Salmon Scotland, and Phil Taylor, the Head of Policy Operations for the Open Seas Trust. Now, Vicky Paxton was going to be joining us remotely. She is from the Partnership Manager for Murray Firth Coastal Partnership, but she is unfortunately unwell and so is unable to join us today. Thank you for those who are here joining us. We've got just over 90 minutes on this session. And just before we move on to questions, I want to make a declaration of interest, which I always do when we discuss salmon in any shape or form. So the committee is aware, and the members on the panel are aware, I am a joint owner of a wild salmon fishery on the east coast of Scotland. That wild salmon fishery generates income and employment into the local economy, and in my mind is not affected by aquaculture on the west coast of Scotland, because the salmon that are migrating from the river that I'm involved with do not move through the aquaculture zone. For clarity, I take the importance of wild salmon to my heart, and I was concerned to see this morning that the International Union for Conservation of Nature have actually listed salmon as part of wild salmon as part of their red list, which causes me concern. So there should be no doubt in anyone's mind that I have an interest, and I'm passionate about it and have been passionate about this subject for probably about 40 odd years, so I'm not going to change. So on that note, we'll move straight to questions, if we may. And the first question I'm going to pass to each of you in turn, so you'll all get a chance to answer it. I've read your submissions to the committee, and I don't think anyone's universally supporting the way that goes where it's going forward. Some people think it doesn't go far enough. Some people don't think it goes too far as it is. So maybe I could just start on the left with you, Claire, and just say, without giving you a platform for an hour and a half, a couple of minutes on why you think it's either good or bad, what we're looking at the moment, and I'll come to you each in turn. Claire.
Sure. Thanks very much for giving me the chance to give evidence today. I think it's a good start. I think we need a biodiversity strategy. These things always seem to come too late or later than we would like them to come. So I think one of the main things that sort of sprung out at me is the lack of strong timelines in there for quite a lot of the actions. Some of them do have timelines, so they've obviously been thought through. Others do not. The other thing is there's a lack of attention to chemical and plastic pollution and the impacts they have on biodiversity. There's a focus obviously from this committee as well on climate change and the impacts that has on biodiversity. But there, according to the IPBES Global Assessment Report that only came out a few years ago, there are five drivers, main drivers, direct drivers of biodiversity loss, and one of those is pollution, and another one of those is climate change. So pollution is a major source. In Scotland especially, the Chemicals Investigation Programme has not been as extensive as in other parts of the United Kingdom, and that needs to be extended and made more transparent. Understanding the pollution that is going into our environment is one of the first steps to mitigating it, and we really don't have enough of that knowledge yet. I think one of the other things was the lack of attribution of responsibility to different bodies. Some of them are named, such as SEPA, to some actions, but others aren't. So then you're going to have a bit of a gap happening. And if people, we've seen this happen in salmon farming with the wild salmon, which you'll be aware of. There was no direct responsibility, so it wasn't being addressed directly. And then you're not going to get allocation of resources. So that is something that has to be laid out quite firmly.
I'm going to stop you going through all of the points, but everyone along the panel's thinking, oh, she's stealing all of my points. Okay. So can I move on? But could I just say my manners left me briefly at the beginning of the meeting, for which I apologise. And I should have welcomed Finlay Carson, who is convener of the RAE Committee, and Rhoda Grant, both of who have joined us today and will be get a chance to ask some questions at the end. So, sorry, Claire, to cut you off. Callum.
Thank you, Chairman. Following the evidence gave last year, was really appreciated the committee recommending to the government that there should be a strategy to tackle the nature emergency. So in terms of the framing of the strategy, we're supportive of that, recognising that there is, you know, a crisis here, and that plays out in the ocean as an ocean emergency. The UN recognises that. So there's much in the draft strategy and action plan that we welcome. Of course, as we've seen with recent events, there needs to be support, and there needs to be political will, and there needs to be funding and resourcing to make sure the welcome actions in that strategy are delivered. The devil will be in the detail in relation to the ecosystem recovery framework in terms of licensing and funding, how the National Marine Plan 2 is developed. There's some actions, they're almost meta-actions, because they're talking about, for example, fisheries management plans, but the concern for us is that what detail is in the fisheries management plans. So there's a number of dependencies there that relate to how the actions that are being recommended are taken forward, and many of those for us around fisheries management. And we're very supportive of sustainable fisheries and sustainable agriculture, but we welcome the fact that the strategy recognises they should be nature-friendly. And the detail of making those nature-friendly depends on how the fisheries management plans and some of the commitments in the Bute House Agreement are delivered, because some of those have actually been dropped. So key for us is actually what does enhanced marine protection look like? We think that is a key part of the suite of measures that we need at sea. We need strict protection. International science and policy makes that clear. So how's that going to be addressed through the strategy? How are the fisheries management plans going to be delivered there? The inshore cap is again a Bute House agreement, but the strategy doesn't mention the second part of that, which is that must be a ceiling from which you reduce pressure that disrupts the seabed. So we welcome the framing of it, but there are the devil's in the detail. It's on how the actions that are in it are then delivered, and there's gaps that we know straight away that aren't even featured in the strategy. And the strategy doesn't even refer to the Marine Nature Conservation Strategy, which has a welcome three-pillared approach, which is a good lens through which to look at improving nature at sea.
Okay, Elspeth, come to you. Elspeth, it's very confusing. You don't need to push the buttons. Don't touch it. The gentleman on your left and on my right pushes the buttons. It helps us, and I'm sure it's going to help you.
I shouldn't be let loose with pressing buttons. That's fine. Thank you, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to give evidence to you today. I think, as Callum has outlined, there's a number of activities, a lot of activities, a lot of policies, a lot of initiatives that are already underway in the marine space. At various stages of development. Some have been running for many, many years, the Marine Protected Area Network, for example. Others are sort of newer to the table, things like the development of the fisheries management plans. But a lot of these seem to be being put into the strategy now, and we don't quite... I think it would be helpful to have some mapping from the government to actually understand how all of these different initiatives are expected to contribute. There seems to be quite a lot of double badging of activities that are underway elsewhere. I think our frustration that we have with this piece of work is we have not been thus far particularly much engaged with its development. The strategic environmental assessment that accompanies the consultation talks about doing that assessment with relevant stakeholders, but we didn't get the opportunity to partake in that or be involved with that. So I think the lack of engagement in the creation of the strategy, the draft delivery plan, and as I said, the SEA is very disappointing. I think a concern that we have running through this is the lack of sort of good baselines. You know, where are we starting from? Where are we starting from, and where are we trying to get to? And I think that's really important when it comes to setting targets and whether targets should be statutory or not, whether they're smart or not, whether a better approach is around looking at trends and qualitative assessments. Because I think without a very clear understanding of the starting point and also a very clear a commitment to science that will be needed to assess whether progress is being made, I think we have to be very careful about being sure about what we are attempting to measure and to assess. I think something else that we felt was very much missing from this package that's currently under consultation is the failure to include a socioeconomic impact assessment. I think that doesn't allow us to answer some of the questions that are in the consultation. The consultation talks about, you know, trade-offs and looking at the impacts on businesses and the economy and society, and it's difficult to do that without having that socioeconomic assessment. I think, too, we have some concerns around the timescales. I think having a rolling sort of five-year delivery plan, 5 years is a very short time period to start to see change of this sort of magnitude that's being suggested here. So whilst this is clearly a necessary endeavour to consider biodiversity loss and how we address it, I think there's a lot of issues with the particular package here in front of us that we would like to
address. Thanks, Elspeth. Tavish.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Parliament for taking an interest in this matter from the marine side. I'd like to share a lot of the concerns that Elspeth articulated, but I would like to say at the outset that the salmon sector absolutely supports Parliament's intention to tackle the biodiversity crisis. That's a laudable aim for parliamentarians, and I look forward to seeing your deliberations as to how you pursue the detail of this, because I think that's the issue that hasn't been looked at in enough with enough parliamentary interest as yet. And as Elspeth said, I don't think you can see this in isolation. You've got to see this biodiversity strategy in the context of all the other strategies that we certainly as an industry are subjected to: the blue economy, the aquaculture vision, the export, the innovation strategies, and indeed the economic transformation strategy that was launched last year. So I think there's a question for parliamentarians about how all these strategies fit together, and is there a consistency of policy purpose behind them? I would suggest that might be an area you'd wish to look at. Two other points. Just on the consultation itself, we have concerns that the way in which this has been run so far mirrors all the mistakes that were made with HPMAs. As Elspeth rightly said, there isn't a baseline on the marine side. Yes, there may be on the terrestrial side, and as you said, Convener, there'll be a panel next year on that. But on the marine side, if I've read the the proposals correctly, by 2025, when you will be considering as a Parliament the National Environment Bill, the marine data will be 10 years out of date. Now, I don't think, and you just need to go back to HPMAs, I don't think that's the baseline that is needed for, as Elspeth rightly said, the robust analysis and setting of targets based on real-time information that allows you as parliamentarians to consider that carefully. So that's point one. Point two is accountability. Just think we need to be really clear about who is responsible for this. I find it incredibly puzzling to find out who actually is the minister in charge of these matters. NatureScot have four ministers, as I'm sure you're aware. I don't know if all four appear in front of you, but I have great sympathy for an agency who's responsible for this, directly responsible for this area, and yet have four ministers. I think there's an accountable... Who is the chief accountable officer? Again, some of the issues you've been dealing with in Parliament over the last number of years seem to me to have fallen down on the basis of the scrutiny of who is actually responsible. And that's really important to business. And the final point is cost. Elspeth was quite right. You could also cite the Business Regulatory Impact Assessment, which, as you know, convener, is a legislative requirement, a very formal requirement on government in terms of proposals that will have a cost. And I think Parliament would want to satisfy itself that it will know the cost. I notice all the work the Finance Committee has been doing on financial memorandums. I applaud that work because it seems to me really important, particularly how in the challenging times that clearly we're in public finance at the moment, for Parliament to be satisfied that they know what the costs of this endeavour will be. And those would be my three suggestions as to where Parliament might want to exercise some oversight. Thank you.
Thanks, Tavish. Phil.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you, Committee, for taking evidence on this really important issue. You asked if it's good or bad, and Claire started by saying it's a good start. I'd like to say that it's not a start. You know, we have had biodiversity strategies in the past, and this is not the first. You know, a key point and a key learning point here for us, I think, needs to be that biodiversity strategies we've had in the past have not met their goals, have failed to prevent the loss that we've seen in the intervening 10 years, and have put us on a trajectory which is somewhat downward. So I'll just focus on, for example, seabirds, great sentinel of the health of the marine environment, because they are picking up the forage fish that everything else is relying on. And just last month, we had the decadal census of seabirds recorded and published, and we saw 40% declines in kittiwakes UK-wide, 35% decline on Arctic tern. These are species that are relying on those top-level forage fish, as well as, you know, above 10% declines on puffins, depending on how you cut the cake. You can put these declines in different figures. We've also seen very significant declines in the health of the marine environment and the habitats that are underpinning it. And the Scottish Marine Assessment, which was published at the end of 2020, presented lots of that information. And I won't rehearse that here. You guys, as a committee, will have understood and received a lot of that information already. So how do we make, you know, this isn't a bad start. And what is good here is it is a very, very welcome occasion to be acknowledging that there's a nature emergency. My learned colleague Tavish even mentioned in their own recognition within the industry of this nature crisis we're in the sea is extremely welcome. And I think that that imparts upon government and this Parliament a real responsibility to address what has happened over the past several decades in our seas and to turn it around. And what we really cannot have, what would be extremely sad and extremely unfulfilling, is for another committee to be sat in 10 years and another set of stakeholders sat here telling you that, sadly, we have still continued these trends, these negative trends, and we now need to come up with a new approach. Tavish spoke about the need for bringing principles together and a sort of principled approach, and I think that that's what there's a real opportunity for within this nature emergency approach that's being taken by government here, mainstreaming. Both Tavish and Elspeth have spoken about the fact that stakeholders haven't been fully consulted in this process. Well, there has been some stakeholder forum, and I believe both of those organisations have been sat on that forum. And one key message that came out of that was the need to make sure that the biodiversity elements here are mainstreamed throughout policies. So they provide guidance. They provide guidance to all of these other strands of work. And they provide then support and mechanisms for those other industrial activities, you know, activities that are designed to help deliver better social economic good, or, you know, better jobs or better export markets, whatever those things are. they also have that thread of biodiversity going through them so that we're not working in silos and not competing with one another. That's integral to what we achieve here. I've got several, there's several ways in which we, this is a great start. This is a good start, is what Claire said. It's a great start to be talking about a nature emergency here in Parliament, and it is a real credit to you as a committee to be taking this evidence now. But it's not quite a start, it's a middle, and there's ways in which this can be significantly improved, and very glad of an opportunity to present some of those ideas here today. I hope that we can provide that support.
Thank you all for starting off like that. I don't think that anyone would agree that the status quo is acceptable, or we've got 10 years to let it run. We probably don't have that. So we'll drill down into the questions. And I think the first ones are going to come from Douglas Lumsden.
Yeah.
Douglas.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just want to drill down a little bit deeper on the delivery plan. I think, Phil, you mentioned about the lack of... Well, no, sorry, Elspeth and Tavish mentioned the lack of engagement. Phil, you seem to suggest there was quite a lot of engagement, so maybe go back to Tavish and Elspeth. You know, was there not a forum that you could contribute to, or why do you feel there was a lack of engagement? But obviously, other people feel it was met.
Yeah, there was very limited. We felt, from our perspective, there was very limited engagement on this. And I think some of the things that we did get involved with, there certainly was a pretty. It wasn't a particularly balanced discussion, I think it would be fair to say. I think a frustration too around. We had a consultation last year on the strategy itself. We contributed to that consultation. But the strategy itself is largely unchanged, other than including some references to things that hadn't been included in the first version of the strategy. So having gone through that exercise last year to find the strategy essentially much the same, only with some additional references, I think, to the Global Biodiversity Framework, sort of begs the question, so, you know, what was the purpose of that consultation? And I think, as I say, when we start to get into now looking at delivery plans and looking at how this is going to turn into something to be implemented, not engaging with businesses about, you know, what are your views on this, why, not engaging us in that process of the strategic environmental assessment, for example, upon which a lot of the delivery plan is based, is disappointing. And I think it means that it's missed an opportunity for organisations like ours to be able to contribute our perspective to that. And as I said a moment ago, we strongly... request that a socioeconomic impact assessment, and as Tavish also said, a business regulatory impact assessment be carried out on these proposals, and we would absolutely want to be much more engaged in these. So, I mean, there is so much going on in the marine space. Callum mentioned many of the other things that are going on at the moment, and we're, you know, having to cover all of these different initiatives, which is absolutely right, and that's what we're here to do, to represent our interests in those different activities and policies that are underway. But I feel that this is one that has not perhaps gone through that same sort of very broad consultative process and sort of getting us to this stage.
Could I add just two thoughts to Elspeth's observations? The first is I do think there's probably a difference in the way in which the agencies, Nature Scot and others, have looked at land use as opposed to marine use. And I suspect marine use, and you'll want to test this as a committee, but I think marine use hasn't had the same level of, certainly there's not the same level of expertise around on it. There's not the same level of baseline information around it, which is the point I was making about baseline information being potentially out of date. And that, I think, is a gap. So I think there's a bit of a catch-up job to be done, if that's helpful, Mr. Lumsden, by the agencies promoting these measures to you as a parliamentarian about have they got the level of expertise and knowledge in order to pursue and prosecute a biodiversity strategy with the far-reaching implications it needs to have in terms of the marine. And the other point, Convener, is a more simple one. We're not just dealing, rightly, as Elspeth says, with this. I mean, my organisation dealt with... 10 Scottish Government and public body consultations in the last year, 4 from the UK Government and 1 from the EU. And next year, we already know there are another 10 coming. So, as Elspeth rightly says, that's what we're here to do. As a trade bodies for our sectors, of course, that's what we do. But please don't see this in isolation. Mm-hmm. There is a heck of a lot of other stuff that flows at us all the time. So you could be critical of us of not attending every meeting we go to. I don't know enough people in my team to go to every meeting we're invited to go to by the Scottish Government. And the government are doing... You know, they're trying to do the right thing. They're creating forums for people to meet. But Believe me, I could bore you all day with a number of meetings we're asked to go to. I think at times there needs to be some focus, some pulling together of these initiatives, and some consistency, at the point I was seeking to make to the convener, some consistency across policy. I'm not sure we see that all the time.
You raised the point of baselines, and maybe can I ask the other sort of members today, do you feel that the proper baselining has been done so we can actually measure things going forward?
There's plenty of data there that enables informed decisions to get on with protecting biodiversity in the ocean. I mean, I've been involved with MPA management workshops going back 8 years, and the measures to protect the remaining inshore sites and offshore sites are 7-8 years delayed. If we start saying, oh, well, we need a fresh baseline, do we really want to delay another 7-8 years? We know we've got some good data in the bag. We need to we need to use that and apply that to make sensible decision making. So there are there are commitments there that need to be delivered in any case. For example, the MP measures that I mentioned, but equally, there's sufficient data that informed a policy recommendation to improve the protection of some vulnerable priority marine features beyond the MPA network. And again, this is a policy commitment that dates back about 7 years. We've got very good records for fragile seabed habitats in particular that we know about, and if we don't get on with protecting those and somehow waiting to collect more data, they might be gone by the time we get round to any action. So it's always going to be more difficult in the ocean. You can't have satellite images showing the extent of habitats. You need to get under the water and do surveys, but there's a really comparatively impressive data set there. I've been in front of this and sister committee several times over the decades saying there's good data there. So we can make good informed policy based on the data that's there. And we just need to get on with it.
Just come in.
Second what Callum said, that there's sufficient data to be making good decisions now. Callum and I have been involved in many of these discussions for a long time, where the data has already showed that action needs to be taken. The lack of data there is not sufficient, and there is plenty of data to provide a baseline. But I said that I'd like to present some ideas and ways in which the committee can potentially progress some of these pieces of thinking. We have, of course, some very significant amounts of funding available from Scottish Government for various activities around marine issues. That's the Marine Fund Scotland, and around nature recovery. So that's the Nature Recovery Fund. And significant amounts of that money is being put into projects which include data collection. My learned colleague over here for the Scottish Fishermen's Federation is running a project on fisheries observer data, paid for by public money through the Scottish Government. Now, that data would inform one of the key actions that's set in the delivery plan to identify spawning and nursery grounds for some of these species. We'd then understand where those small fish are, where they're being bycaught, and how then we can develop policies around that. That data is not in its current system being made publicly available in that way. And there's a real opportunity then to ensure that those uses of public money around this work are delivering. And I'm not singling out that project, but I didn't mean to in a sort of exemplary way. I meant to just simply suggest that there are projects like that which can easily collect data, that are collecting data, and can easily present that data into the spaces where those decisions need to be made. It's already being collected using public money. Why don't we make it a condition that data is then put into public forum?
I guess when you're saying that is in progress just now, does that not highlight that the baseline data is not actually there?
As far as needs to be done first? I don't want to speak for my colleague. But
if I can just clarify what the purpose of that particular programme is. This is an independent fishery science support scheme. It, as Phil said, it is about providing data from fisheries observers. That is not a programme that has a great deal of flexibility around it. The whole purpose of the programme is to meet, we deliver for the Scottish Government, their obligations to the fisheries data that they are required to produce for ICES stock assessments. So that is the purpose of that programme. We've been doing that now for, I think, about 15 years, initially through EMFF funding, through European Union funding, and since the UK left the EU through Marine Fund Scotland, as Phil rightly said. But that programme is specifically about providing the fishery observer data that the Scottish Government is legally required to submit into the ICES stock assessment process. And I might also add that whilst we are exceptionally grateful to the Scottish Government for making those resources available through Marine Fund Scotland, because it's a really important part of the stock assessment to have that data, we are concerned that we don't have very much, indeed any, sort of long-term funding commitment to it. We enter into a process every year with Scottish Government about whether there will be resources to continue that programme. Obviously, we have to have people running that programme who understand what they're doing, they're skilled, they're knowledgeable, and it can be quite hard to retain those people through a programme when you can't make any commitment beyond a one-year funding settlement. So we obviously understand the funding pressures that the government faces, but I think that's quite a good example, actually, of how that not having that long-term commitment to funding science in the marine space can actually be a very, very limiting factor.
Okay, thank you. And just going to one more question. In terms of, I think, Elspeth, you mentioned 5 years isn't sort of long enough for this plan. What's your views on everyone else? Is 5 years not ambitious enough, or should we be looking at further?
I would agree that 5 years isn't long enough. I think you maybe have 5 year stages, and then reassess after every 5 years. But I would say you'd be wanting to put something probably 15 years type of framework in place. Some of these things are going to take years to work out. And then, for example, the delivery plan has a lot of reference to plans in, but not how to implement those plans. So in 5 years, you may come up with lots of plans, and then there's no actual plan to implement the plans. So you need to be having a longer framework in place, in my opinion.
Okay. Anyone else?
It's my view that we can't afford in this first iteration to have a longer time frame than 5 years, but I think that Claire's suggestion that 5 years be an interim step is a very good one. I think that Claire's point that lots of the proposed deliveries, items, actions, are in fact plans, just shows that we need that deadline sooner. You know, we have in the marine space, the marine director has, you know, an allergy to meeting deadlines. You know, we've talked already about the marine protected areas stuff. We've already talked about the fact that deadlines have been failed consistently around that. In June, when Cabinet Secretary McCallum made her statements about highly protected marine areas, she committed to consultations around offshore marine protected areas on the other side of summer recess. Those still haven't been brought to the table, and we're coming to the end of the year, and I believe that they've now been pushed into next year. This is this sort of addiction to setting targets and failing targets is a real serious issue in this space, and is one of the main reasons why I'm not particularly happy with what's in the proposed delivery plan, because it itself includes several delays on set targets. So we need that deadline soon, and we need that deadline to be smart. You know, we need those targets to be smart, and we need that deadline to be firm. And yeah, that's I'm not going to suggest I know more about how you, as a committee, will engage with those, but clearly there's a very significant role for a parliamentary committee there to hold government to account to what it says it's going to do, and we would really appreciate that action. Thank you.
Tavish wants to come just explain why the industry won't invest in a five-year plan, or will it?
No, we invest in 20-year plans in terms of my sector, so no bother at all with five-year plans. Just to help Mr. Lumsden, and I think Phil's last point is right about oversight, Callum and I might slightly differ on our perspective on the science. Not that I disagree at all with Callum's point about the specific areas where science absolutely has a bedrock and a baseline, but if you take the marine environment as a whole, all. I don't think anyone could argue that. So maybe the better question for parliamentarians is to ask the Marine Directorate about their science strategy. I think we'd all agree on that. And the quantum of the monies going into science. Because whatever we may debate today in front of you and whatever we may forward to you, I'm not sure the Marine Directorate's science quantum, their budget, is adequate for the needs that we'd all have, whether it's business or conservation organisations, in terms of supporting the long-term aspirations that we have. And that might be something you may wish to explore.
Douglas, Mark wants to come in, so I'm going to bring Mark in, and I know Callum's wanted to come in, so maybe you could, I'll let you come in, I'll come back to you, Douglas.
A brief point, Convener. I was picking up on what Elspeth and Tavish were talking about in relation to strategic environmental assessment. I'm just interested to know at what level you would wish to be more involved within that, whether that's the screening stage, scoping stage, development of the environmental report. So I'm trying to understand what that kind of missing bit of engagement was and how appropriate it is for you to be involved at different stages. And I think given what you said yourself, Tavish, that you don't have enough staff to go to every single meeting, how involved can you be in the science and setting of baselines that's required through that kind of process? So can you just tell me what you felt was missing through your engagement in that SEA process?
Well, I think certainly what that environmental assessment did in this case was, I think there were certainly two areas there was quite a strong focus on, whether restoration or regeneration was the right approach and what the sort of time frame for approach should be. Should it be a longer term or a shorter term time frame? And certainly the impression from the assessment is that stakeholders' views were involved in how that assessment was then presented in the final document. I think in general, we are frequently involved in strategic environmental assessments. We would be involved at a scoping stage to see what should be in it. We would then be consulted. We're often engaged in this on marine licensing applications, for example. We were recently able to contribute to the scoping stage of the SEA for the National Marine Plan too. So it's very common for us to be involved in these things. You're absolutely right, as Tavish said, and as I have said, we are stretched over a number of areas, but we are also good at prioritising our time and understanding where we need to really focus and whether there are other areas where we have to put to one side if there's a higher priority. But this is an area that we would have wished to have been more involved in, and it certainly appears from the document that there was a stakeholder engagement in this, but it certainly didn't involve ourselves.
Okay. Yeah, I suppose, Mr. Ruskell, the balance for all of us is certainly in business is stakeholder engagement as opposed to really affecting decisions. You make a very good point about what role is there, what is the appropriate role, and that's a judgment parliamentarians have to come to, and ultimately Nature Scotland government have to come to. We'll attend as many meetings as we possibly can when invited by Nature Scotland and indeed by core government. We'll do our level best to always be part of the process, but when it comes to these kind of judgments, that's why we've highlighted the importance of a socio-economic study, which I think Nature Scotland are sympathetic to, and I'm very grateful for their consideration of that, because it does strike me, and you and I may have debated this in the past, but the important balance between environmental, social and economic factors is at the heart of these, they're always going to be at the heart of policy making in this area. And we'll all come to a slightly different perspective on this, but you'd be not be surprised to hear those of us who represent organisations, companies and businesses seeking to create wealth in Scotland today, that we will do our best to make that, to make that business case. And we have great confidence in the systems that government have put in place, which are there under legislation, notably the BREEA, the Business Regulatory Impact Assessment and the socio-economic study. And we hope that those will be part of this ongoing process. Okay. But I entirely take your point that we'll do our best to attend every meeting we can.
Yeah. Helen would like to come in.
Thank you. I just wanted to reflect a little bit on targets, timelines, baseline in relation to this discussion and some of the comments. Clearly, we're not going to have our seas in the state that they should be in 5 years. That's not the point. The point is to have
the plans commence so that there's targets that ensure decline of nature is halted by 2030. It was supposed to be halted in 2010. I can remember that one or two. And by 2045, you've got net nature positive. So we need to get the policy commitments and actions that are already delayed, progressed and in the bag. They need to be done. We need to do that, and there's plenty of data to do that. This discussion also highlights the importance of, you know, the sister aspect to that, this, which is the need for nature recovery targets in law. And this is where this space is catching up, or seeking to catch up with the climate change discussion, where there's climate change targets in law. And yes, some targets will be missed, but the difference is if we get them into law, it creates leverage to make sure that they happen and drives the seriousness with which policy and sectoral action needs to take the biodiversity emergency. Because Phil touched on it, previous biodiversity strategies, good actions in them, many of them not implemented because they don't have a legal hook, some leverage to make sure that they happen. So we need to get... So there's that aspect. And the other thing to be clear on, again, just coming back to baselines, I don't want the committee to have a picture of this kind of blank canvas. There's incredibly detailed data breakdown in Scotland's marine assessment. Yes, some of it's modelled, because as I said before, you don't have satellite imagery that can see through the ocean to the seabed. There's incredibly detailed one there. And I just... I beg your patience here. Just for the last point, we have submitted evidence of decline before. The biodiversity strategy has that in the intro, but I just wanted to update it with the OSPAR quality status report. So this is the state of the Northeast Atlantic, OSPAR 2023 report. Majority of 22 fish species assessed in the Northeast Atlantic in poor state, 8 of 9 OSPAR habitats in the Greater North Sea in poor condition, 1 unknown in the unknown condition. 6 of 7 habitats in poor condition in the Celtic Seas, with the 7th unknown. Plankton not in good condition, seabirds not in good condition, marine mammals not in good condition, food webs of great concern. You know, this is the experts in the Northeast Atlantic presenting a very troubling picture. We need to get on with action.
Perfect. Douglas, do you want to come back on any of
just
that?
Just really one last point, and it's around the socio-economic study that's been mentioned by a couple of people. In terms of Claire, Callum, Phil, what's your view on that? Obviously, we've heard from Elspeth and Tavish. Maybe Claire, first of all.
Sure. I think socio-economic assessment is really important, and also a business impact assessment, but I think they can also follow. I don't think they should be, I don't think this action should be paused at all in order to then carry them out. I think a lot of these actions can be started immediately. And the same with, you know, Callum has mentioned the amount of data that's available for baseline already. That aside, you don't necessarily need baseline data to start preventing pollution. So I don't think, you know, we now have a UK regulator for chemicals, for example. Each of the individual nations can submit to that UK regulator any chemicals of concern that they would like to see stronger regulation on. And I don't think the individual nations actually know that. So we can start looking at chemicals of concern that are entering the marine environment ourselves and working to prevent that happening, because we know that's going to be having an impact on biodiversity already.
Okay. I'm just thinking, can you really do the socio-economic study afterwards? Because if you're not read, then obviously some of the things may be implemented may actually cause harm to the social and economic benefits of a community.
I'm not saying start all the actions, complete them, and then do the socio-economic study. But there are some actions that can be started already. There are some in progress already. There are some that have been delayed. I think we don't want to delay this any longer in order to do a socioeconomic impact assessment.
Okay. Callum?
I think the it's important that there are socioeconomic impact assessments of policy. That's part of policy development. It's important that when those are done, they also look at the socioeconomic benefits of policy. And I think I'd like to make that point in this space, because I often feel there's an unfortunate sort of, I call it a false dichotomy, a sort of polarisation of action for biodiversity can challenge well-being and economic benefit. And if that's a perception, we're doing something wrong collectively. So we need, but it's more difficult to get the data to show socioeconomic benefit, including indirect benefits. And we saw that with the recent discussions around the HPMA measures. Done right, these conservation measures are about helping shore up local socioeconomic benefit and helping provide local sustainable opportunities in local sustainable businesses, whether that's capture fisheries or aquaculture or any of the other sectors that aren't represented here. So I just wanted to make that, that point of principle.
And Phil?
I think it's just a question of where you put the socioeconomic impact assessment, and I suppose that's a question for government and then for Parliament to scrutinise. Elspeth spoke about prioritisation and where they would invest their time in sort of evaluating these socioeconomic impact assessments. So the delivery plan is a suite of many actions which go marine, terrestrial, and some in the middle, you know, coastal. And each of those policies, when they come into an actual action or something that's going to change on the water, which is where our interest really lies, will at that point obviously have a socioeconomic impact assessment. So take, for example, the priority marine feature protection. So that's a process that's been underway since 2017 and that has already gone through several rounds of SEA and socioeconomic impact assessment and strategic environmental assessment. We as stakeholders have been involved throughout that process. There will, as that comes to be delivered in a practical way, so far it's been very theoretical, high-level discussions, as that's delivered in a practical way, I'm not going to speak for government, but I presume they're going to deliver a socioeconomic and BRIAR impact assessment and a business regulatory impact assessment. I'll engage with it at that point. I don't know that there's necessarily much value in engaging with it at the delivery plan stage, because the social impact assessment will be so big and expansive, it will have to offset the value of, for example, delivering that policy, which will deliver economic benefits to low-impact fisheries as well as environmental benefits to benefits to the environment, against a policy about upland moorland restoration, which will probably impact on the same community. Let's take the area around Torridon or Ullapool, for example. Those policies are going to be impacting the communities of those towns, villages. And I think at the delivery plan stage, it's going to be such a big, complicated, confusing and overlapping picture socioeconomically that I don't think that that's the right place to engage with it myself, but clearly I pay attention to it. I think the place to engage with it is in the delivery of those policies as they come down. And as I said at the beginning, the key opportunity here is to put a thread of biodiversity through everything so that those individual policies and those individual official teams, because these are teams of individuals at government having to sort of wrangle with quite a competing demand put on them, have clarity as to how biodiversity should be mainstreamed into, let's say, fisheries licensing, which is, as you know, subject to a legal dispute between ourselves and the Scottish Government, or upland management, or terrestrial planning, or offshore planning. That's the key here. That's the real opportunity here, I think. Sorry.
Sorry, can I just say, I've tried to let this conversation run, which of course is going to come back and bite me at the end, because not every committee member will get everything they want out of this session. So I'm going to slightly squeeze each of you to give a succinct answer as possible. I'm going to move straight to Bob Doris next for the next lot of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Once you ask my question, might ask yourself, Convener, just to work out who's answering, because it's quite challenging not being in the room. But I've been listening carefully to the evidence we've received so far, Convener, and a lot of it's process-driven. But the delivery plan needs to identify meaningful, appropriate actions across key sectors, groups or regulatory areas. So I'd be quite keen to know where the witnesses believes that is contained within the delivery plan, or what more can be done to make sure that it does exist within what is currently a draft delivery plan, of course, and the key areas we think of is fishing, aquaculture, plastics and chemicals, regional and community coastal partnerships, and I acknowledge that it would appear, according to SPICE, that there's no apparent actions in the delivery plan in relation to marine renewables. So what is there in the plan that can deliver identifiable, meaningful and appropriate actions across key sectors, just so that we're clear about what could potentially work well, but also where the gaps are?
Okay, I'm going to go to Elspeth first. Sorry, if you all look, if none of you throw your hands up, I will just nominate somebody, which is always dangerous, but because I won't nominate the same person each time. But Elspeth, and then I'll probably come to either Phil or Callum. So Elspeth.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. That's a really helpful question, and I think it touches back to something I said, I think, in my opening remarks about doing some mapping of what is in the delivery plan. I think the way that the delivery plan is set out is not a particularly helpful way of actually seeing, is this a really sort of holistic and correct approach to deliver the objectives. So it feels a little bit like it's pulling together a lot of things that are already underway, as others have said. You know, we've been working on Marine Protected Area Network for 15 years, we've been working on Priority Marine Features for 6 years, we've been all very involved in that. But it feels a little bit like the delivery plan is sort of double badging and sort of pulling together a lot of things that have started somewhere else and have been perhaps designed for other purposes. The Fisheries Management Plan, for example, fisheries management plans have come from the new UK Fisheries Act, and there's lots of objectives that these fisheries management plans have to meet, and there will be a lot of different objectives that they will have to balance to achieve their overall purpose. So it feels, I think it would be more helpful to undertake some sort of mapping of certainly trying to extract the marine elements from the delivery plan, because as Phil said, it covers all environments. And actually see, you know, are these the actions that are going to deliver the change that we need? And if so, in what sort of sequence should they be done? How are they going to be resourced? I think there's been a lot of discussion already about the resources for the delivery of all of these things. When you look at the timelines that are set out in the delivery plan, it's all very high level. There's not a lot of detail underneath them, but there's a huge amount of detail that sits underneath every single one of these actions. There's a lot of work that will be needed to deliver every single one of them. None of these things in the marine are particularly straightforward or quick to do. So I think there needs to be a much better way of drawing together the different elements of work that the strategy and the delivery plan feel are required to deliver the objectives of the strategy, to map these properly in relation to the marine environment, and then to look very carefully at, so what is the priority for those things and how are they going to be resourced? Because, as I say, I feel that there's a huge amount of detail that is not in the plan, and that the devil will be in the detail, actually, of how these things can be delivered.
See, just before the next witness comes in, can I just check, and I put on record that I don't have any depth of experience in relation to this, but again, that was quite process-driven, and it's about mapping out, let's see what should be in the plan. My question was about what is in the plan and what you think is identifiable and might be beneficial and achievable. I get that witnesses might think there should be things removed from the plan, other things put in the plan, pulling things together. And again, I'm now starting to talk in very general terms myself and asking the question. But is there anything in the plan that's identifiable that you think is of value and would be beneficial?
Well, the priority marine features, obviously, we've spoken already about them. That process started a number of years ago. The purpose of those was to protect biodiversity out with the existing marine protected area network. So clearly that is the purpose of those, is to improve the situation with marine biodiversity. And we've been very engaged in that process, absolutely want to strike that right balance between how we have conservation and protection of our marine environment, but how we also have sustainable use. So absolutely, lots of the things in the plan can deliver the objectives of the strategy, but it feels too disparate at the moment to actually see how we go about doing that. I think we have to be really clear about the fact that we do not have endless amounts of money to deliver this, and we need to spend the money that is going to be available for this on the right things at the right times and in the right way. And I think that's critically important.
C- Callum, you want to come in?
Yeah, no, thank you, and good question. I'm going to briefly introduce another strategy here, which is the Marine Nature Conservation Strategy, which actually predates the Marine Act, and that is a useful lens which I think would be good to look at organising the actions in the biodiversity strategy through for the marine environment, because it talks about a three-pillar approach to nature conservation. So that's recognising species-specific measures, site-specific measures, and wider seas measures such as fisheries management and planning. So you do that filter, and then there's lots of welcome actions. I touched on some of them in my introduction. Some of them are things that are committed to anyway that should be happening, but of course they should be in the plan because they're part of that sort of three-pillared approach. So having the MPA measures, having the PMF measures that are delayed, and you know, we might have a slightly different view about how those should be implemented. We think there should be a whole site approach to have fisheries protection measures across seabed MPAs, for example, and there's discussions about how protecting the PMFs can be done in a spatial way. We just, for transparency on the record, I've put in this room or one of these rooms, I've said that one of the scenarios that I put forward for strategic environment assessment testing was a distance from shore closure, like half nautical mile, as part of the SEAs. So there's different ways that you can look at how you can put in place those measures. The seabird strategy, the cetacean strategy, there's lots of things that are in there that should be happening anyway. To answer your question, there are some additionals. So the ecosystem recovery framework is welcome. In order to have a meaningful framework, that needs to look really clearly at licensing, because it's difficult to license ecosystem restoration. You need to use rather clunky existing licenses, such as construction licenses. So again, that's an action to have a plan or a framework, but it's something new and welcome and additional that's in the biodiversity strategy. And for that framework to work, you need to improve licensing, you need to have the funding in place. And that's another huge discussion about adequate funding for restoration. We have SMEEF, Scottish Marine Environment Enhancement Framework Fund, sorry, that doesn't have enough funding. How can we get more funding to support restoration? And there's also the commitment to protect vulnerable marine ecosystems between 400 and 800 metres. That is a new welcome addition. And just for transparency, we actually said the closure should be as shallow as 600 metres. We've said that in the past. So the three-pillar approach lens, existing things, and there are some new things in there.
I'm sure you'll get the hang of this by the end, Callum, but if I cough gently and go like that, it means you're about to wind up. It just means I don't have to cut your microphone off. Let Tavish in very briefly, if you can do that, Tavish, and then Claire, and then back to you, Bob.
Thank you, Convener. Just to help Mr. Doris, and it's a fair point, I think the point I'm agreeing with Elspeth on, Mr. Doris, is that if that mapping exercise does not take place, then I think the delivery plan and the strategy will be challenging when it comes to the strategic environmental assessment and to the socio-economic assessment and to the BREEA. So we're trying to help the committee and help indeed the promoters of this initiative by pointing out that I think what that mapping exercise does is give you comfort that those things have been covered off.
Yes, thank you. I think there are some good references in there as far as plastic and chemical pollution are concerned. You know, we welcome the action to develop policy by 2028 to address contaminants that exceed the OSPA threshold values, although we'd like to see a shorter timescale than that, obviously. Reduce marine litter and marine plastics through enabling improved plastic pellet handling. That's very welcomed as well. And that's got a timeline of 2025. So, you know, there are some sort of short timelines in there. And then as far as aquaculture goes, it references the aquaculture vision, which we're supportive of quite a lot of the intended outcomes of that. Again, not great timescales in the vision, however. And then also references to support CEPRA in the implementation of the sea lice risk assessment framework. So as far as aquaculture and plastics and chemicals goes, there are some good references in there, and references, as I said before, to the chemical investigation programme. But again, Scotland has not got a lot of detail around it compared to the other nations.
Bob, do you have any further questions?
No, Convener, it was genuinely very helpful. I'm conscious this is a draft delivery plan and witnesses will want to try and shape what that final delivery plan looks like, and therefore what we hear is things that are not in the plan, mapping exercises and other matters, but it's important the committee hears what is in the plan that would be welcome and could make meaningful changes. I think we've got some of that, so I won't come back in, convener.
Okay, and it would help if any witnesses thought there were particular things that we'd missed out on the plan, that they add that as a bit. Callum, I'm going to ignore that, but because I need to go to the next person. But if you've got a additional stuff you'd like to see in there, please could you come back to us? I'm going to go to the next question, which is going to come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I'd like to come to the topic of the 30 by 30 targets that are, of course, in, you know, embodied in the global biodiversity framework, hugely important. But ask you specifically what you think the implications are for both designating protected marine areas, but also the management of those marine areas, and also to get your reflection, given comments that you made earlier on about mainstreaming. Where do you think these targets should sit? Should they sit at the top of the aquaculture strategy? Should it be there for the fisheries strategy as well? Should they be an explicit ambition or a secondary ambition for sectors to be working towards the delivery? So maybe I would just start from the right and then we'll move across the table. So
that's your left, I think. Your right.
Oh, it
and
is,
left.
Yeah. Indeed. I'm left-hander, so I Phil. Work that way. Phil.
Thank you. And thanks for the question. So you asked where should they sit. I think it's the National Marine Plan. It's the overarching policy here. But as part of mainstreaming, they should sit in everything subsidiary to that too. The National Marine Plan is the key delivery mechanism for delivering spatial management in our sea, using the key legislation for management of Scotland's seas. In fact, it's the legislation that gives Scottish ministers powers for the waters beyond 12 nautical miles. So that 2010 legislation provides that entire framework, and it is within that that they should be established. There should be a mechanism for the distribution, the planning of other activities around that 2030 30% target. The key issue with the 30 by 30 is, of course, as you've noted, the lack of management. And the majority of the Marine Protected Area Network, as it stands at the moment, doesn't have that. Management from fisheries activities in particular, which are causing harm within them, as we've evidenced just last year using our own ROV underwater data. In fact, over the past 10 years, we've arguably gone backwards with a marine protected area designated for protecting spawning and juvenile fish, what's known as WINSOC, actually losing protection, so trawling being permitted within that area, having initially been banned. So we've actually gone backwards rather than forwards. So again, this point about the last decade has been, you know, a bit of a failure. We need to really step up our game, and there's a real opportunity here for us. So, if it's mainstreaming, it needs to be in everything. And you mentioned a suite of policies there that this target needs to sit within as well. But the top of that tree, in my opinion, is the National Marine Plan, and we need to see that implemented across industries and policies. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell, so 2 points for you, if I may. The first is, there are many existing marine designations in the marine space which have sea farms within them. So we have lived for 30 years as an industry with a continuous suite of marine designations that, of course, used to flow out of the European Union and now a devolved responsibility of Edinburgh. So, a sensible balance, that's my point about the sensible balance, as we've discussed, between the environment, social and economic factors can be achieved. I would readily suggest, and we would be happy to submit an additional note on that if the convener so wanted to make to speak to that particular point in terms of detail. Where does it sit? Phil makes an entirely fair point about the National Marine Plan. The only observation I'd make is that some of our areas around the coast are way ahead of where national policy has been on this. Shetland was doing a local marine plan in 2000-2001, and it was to try and sort out the spatial squeeze issues long before spatial squeeze became the issue we were all much more obsessed by in current terms. And that was because at that stage, even then, in the islands I was very much part of home, we were already dealing with those challenges. And the environmental one was there. And that's why we at that time made sure our local fisheries college could put money into science and try and baseline what was going on, for example, in the inshore fisheries issues. And it worked. So I entirely take the point that there has to be an overarching marine national plan, but I would encourage Parliament to think carefully about the areas of our coastal communities who are actually really good at this stuff, know it inside out, and actually have, if I may say so, some degree of success in delivering a local marine plan which achieves that sensible balance between these factors.
Can I just say that would that then feed into more designation of marine protected areas? I won't put an H on the front of it, but would that sort of approach that you suggested is working in Shetland
so I'm very
lead to more designation and better management? Because that is the objective of 3030.
I'm very comfortable with science and data and evidence being behind the policy consideration of more marine designations. I think where these things fell down, if I may say so, where HBMAs absolutely fell down is those promoting it couldn't say what the evidence was behind it. Now, I know you'll disagree with that, but I think some of us very strongly argued that, and government accepted that argument. What I would plead with, Mr. Ruskell, is don't try and do HBMAs by the back door. Make sure that if you're going to be upfront about more designations, you say what will be allowed and what won't be allowed, because the big challenge, as we know with HBMAs, is that nothing was going to happen in those areas. And not unsurprisingly, people like me who lived in Shetland all my life are never going to accept that as a mechanism. So to win your argument, you have to put data, evidence and science behind it. That is a fair way to proceed.
Okay, Elspeth, yes, can we get you back to the 30-30?
Yes, thank you. In relation to the 30-30, of course, in relation to marine protected areas, we're already there in terms of the designations. We've got 37% of Scotland's seas designated as HPMAs, but as others have said, and I completely agree, the management measures are not yet in place for the majority of these sites, and that process has been delayed both for the inshore ones and the offshore ones. Government has set out its intended timescales for doing those, and we know that those are behind. But we are fully committed to engaging with that process, have been engaged in that process from the outset, and will continue to be so. As I say, I think the key challenge is finding the right management measures that strike the right balance between protecting sites, protecting conservation, protecting nature, but also allowing sustainable use. And I think that harks to the point that Tavish made. In terms of where targets sit, I think it's, or where targets should sit, I think there's a step before that, which is about thinking really hard about what targets should be set and how they should be set. I think we have concerns about the setting of statutory quantitative targets. I think in an area where, for all the reasons we've already discussed, we have data, but we don't have comprehensive data, and we know that there will be issues around resources to monitor and check compliance with targets. So I think we have to be cautious about that, and we have to think about other indicators. And I think, thinking specifically about fisheries, we have now a legal obligation to deliver the fisheries management plans requirements of the Fisheries Act, and they have to balance a number of different objectives, of which protection of the marine environment, protection of species and habitats is absolutely one. So I think there's layers through which these will sit.
Okay. Calm.
Yeah, I agree with Phil. The National Marine Plan has to be the overarching framework. The biodiversity strategy should be the thread through all sectoral strategies, because underpins sustainable work, sustainable activity. To achieve 30 by 30, much of the network are currently paper parks, so we need the measures in place. And you know, we've worked closely with SFF and others on those. We might agree to disagree, but it's been a constructive process. And to put that into perspective, only 0.6% of the inshore area that is historically trawled is currently protected within the existing MPA network. So there's a long way to go to get the measures in for the existing network. But on 30 by 30, I'd just like to also acknowledge the Convention of Biodiversity recommends a balance within the MPA networks between sites where all extractive activities are prohibited
to ensure nature resilience and recovery in sites with sustainable uses permitted. And it's really unfortunate how the HPMA process went, because for me it's almost a framing issue. If you say, can we work with you, local communities, places that maybe are less important, or places that you want to see enhanced or recovered, and you know, international science shows us that you can increase the amount of sea life in those areas by 5 times, and let's plan this and think about where these could go, and that can help your local fishery. You know, that's a positive thing. We mustn't see these things as draconian or shutting down activity. It's the opposite. So that needs to still be part of the conversations, part of the discussion. And the science is there that does show the benefit of these kinds of areas.
Okay.
Whether that was communicated or not as part of the consultation, I'll leave others to judge. But
indeed. Right, Claire.
Okay.
I mean, I also, you know, support the overarching application of the National Marine Plan. I think there needs to be, that you need to ensure that there is enough resources for local planning authorities, for example, when you're talking about things such as aquaculture applications, to really assess the impacts they're going to have. I think we may have a lot of protected areas on paper at the moment, but how effective are they actually being? The Firth of Forth is one of the most highly polluted areas of the world as far as plastic pellet production goes, and one of the worst sites is SSSI in South Queensferry. So, you know, while we have those protected areas at the moment, it's not enough, and we need to see more.
Okay. Okay. I know time is marching on, but I've got one more question, and maybe I'll just focus this on a couple of panel members, and it's about fisheries management. I mean, we've already touched on this. So sticking with 30-30 now, sticking with targets, sticking with nature restoration, ecological restoration within our seas, what are your thoughts on the current approach with fisheries management? Is it actually delivering that objective? What needs to change? So I'm going to bring in Phil, and then Elspeth, and then Callum, I think, on this.
Thank you. No, I don't believe that it is. That's backed up in particular by the Scottish Marine Assessment, concluding that fisheries was the main and the most widespread main pressure on the marine environment, and the impacts included removal of non-target species, such as bycatch, much of which is being discarded, and much of which includes juvenile fish, and surface abrasion, which is just a sort of technical way of saying, you know, the impact of dragging a net or a dredge across the sea floor. The way to address it, in my opinion, is to integrate, to ensure some of this biodiversity strategy and the thinking around it is integrated into fisheries decision making. We've already talked about the National Marine Plan, and I've mentioned in passing our own legal challenge to the Scottish Government, in which we argued that the Scottish Government must take account of the National Marine Plan when it makes fisheries licensing decisions. The Scottish Government is, in effect, I'm strawmanning this somewhat, but bear with me, argued that they don't have to in those licensing decisions specifically. Now, the judge has decided in our favour in that case, but it's going through an appeals process. It's just a good example, though, of how things are siloized and how the environment, and you know, these are really fragile, beautiful places, which I would entreat any committee members, if they wish, in the summer to come out and see with us using our underwater drones. Really beautiful, wild places, very important for the functioning of the ecosystem. These are places that act as nursery habitats or spawning grounds that need protected. And we've already spoken about the fact that the MPAs, the Priority Marine Feature Review, but also these additional delivery plan actions, such as the protection of spawning and nursery grounds, which is an additional action that I would have mentioned if I responded to Mr. Doris's question. These are real opportunities within this policy here to actually start to deliver protection for those ecosystems and then to start to recover the ecosystem above. And that's a really, that recovery is going to be really fundamental to places like the inshore west coast of Scotland, where, as committee members will be aware, much of the ecosystem in that area is somewhat degraded. And rather than being this vibrant, colourful place, it's a bit of a brown, flat substrate underneath a grey sea. I think there is progress being made in terms of opening up some of the dialogue around this and ensuring that biodiversity is considered within these fisheries decisions. But I am also somewhat saddened by the fact that, as Callum mentioned, he and I, you know, have been involved in the MPA management for a long time. And in 2015, for example, we were involved in a workshop with fishery stakeholders, including active skippers, to discuss management on the map. You know, actual, this area protected, that area not, how does this all work out in a very specific way? And that was a really detailed but very productive meeting in some ways. We came to some agreements, we had to make concessions, there was a lot of progress made, I felt, but none of that was implemented following that meeting, and it was all taken off the table and taken away into back rooms that then were lobbied against. And that's where some of this stuff's falling down, and that's where, you know, not to take this to a process point, Mr. Doris, but, you know, that's where some of the process issues around these outcomes that we all want here really need to be better scrutinised and better challenged by Parliament. Sorry.
Okay, thanks. Elspeth?
Yeah. Could I just caution you that this is not the place to air opinions on either side. We've mentioned it. I'd rather we moved sideways from it and let it take its course through the natural procedure. Sorry to interrupt, Mark.
Yeah, could go back to...
Thank you. Yes, the Scottish Government has an extensive programme of activities around fisheries management. We've touched on some of these today. This Future of Fisheries Management Strategy, which dates back to about 2019, I think 2020. We've now got the Fisheries UK Fisheries Act and all the FMPs that have to come from that. We have 20 FMPs, or at least 20, to have in place by the end of next year. I think... there's a lot of policy development underway, things like future catching policy, and that is a critically important part to addressing some of the things that Phil has perhaps touched on, or although perhaps rather oversimplified the complexity of some of them. But I think the challenge that we have at the moment is, I think we have moved from a space of actually being able to have constructive discussion and really look at proper practical problem solving and finding constructive ways forward, into a space now where I feel there are perhaps, you know, too many barriers to finding actually practical problem solving and actually finding ways to do our fisheries management better. Our industry is committed to good fisheries management. Our future success depends upon it. We've been very heartened this year to see a suite of scientific advice from ICES on many of our commercial stocks that is really positive. We've been able to allocate a catch of cod on the West Coast for the first time in a number of years. There's some really positive things there. But there is a pretty extensive ambition for fisheries management that the Scottish Government has, but I don't think that the current model of going about that is actually helping us find solutions.
Do you members, though, fundamentally see the need for restoration in the inshore?
Well, I think there's... The strategic environmental assessment was interesting in this, because it talked a lot about restoration and regeneration, and I think tended to come down on the side more of regeneration rather than trying to restore something if conditions have changed in such a way, whether that's climate or whatever has changed in a way that you can't actually restore something to the conditions of the past. And also, where do you decide the past was? You know, what are you restoring it to? Is it 10 years, 20, 100, 200, 1,000? How do you decide that point? I think there are probably specific cases where restoration may be a good idea and may be possible, things like maybe oyster beds, for example.
But regeneration then? Do you members support regeneration in the inshore? And is a cap part of that?
Well, again, I think the suggestion, well, we haven't yet seen any proposals from government of a cap. Idea of the inshore cap came from the Butte House Agreement. It has not seen the light of day in terms of any detail. So I think until we see the detail of what the government is thinking on that, it's hard to have a view on
that. So you'd like to see the detail on that?
We certainly support a much more mixed fisheries economy. We think that creating you know, that sort of complete fleet segregation on the basis of geographic limits is an oversimplified approach. And we think that, for example, the use of the inshore marine protected areas is a much better way of saying if you've got habitat, species, features that need to be protected in your inshore waters, use that MPA network to do it. And that's the process that we have all been part of, albeit it has been going extremely slowly. But we should allow that to run its course. We should allow the review of that process that is properly built into it to run its course and then tell us, is there still a problem? Is there a problem that we're trying to fix? If so, what is the way to go about that?
Okay. Callum.
Thank you. And excuse me front-loading some of my answers to this earlier, if I'd known this question was arising.
To this one brief.
We run the Good Fish Guide. We assess over 600 stocks and species. We want to see as many of them green-rated as possible. We support sustainable fishing. And we recognise that, you know, industry will work within the framework and that artefacts can arise from that if the framework is flawed. And if there's an unknown there, that obviously can create fear and uncertainty. So we've long called for clarity for spatial management of fishing. The MPA process was productive because you had a discrete bit of sea and you had a discussion about how you use that space. And I've long said we need to have that discussion for in chunks for the whole of Scotland seas in relation to fisheries. And I think that's particularly keenly needed for the inshore. Getting back to Mr. Doris's point, the part missing from the biodiversity strategy was a part that we support, which is the second half of the inshore cap, which would be a ceiling from which to reduce pressure on an evidence basis. But that would need to include all stakeholders in a transparent decision, so everybody feels part of that discussion. Because with respect, it's not just about getting the important areas protected and recovered. It's about better managing the conflicts within the industry, and that's particularly the case inshore. And we gave quite detailed written evidence to the committee on the petition on the inshore limit on that, where we were saying that the range of commitments, if implemented well, some of which are in the biodiversity strategy, could take us towards a low-impact zone inshore. So really keen will be the National Marine Plan and General Policy 9 within that needs to survive. And that needs to be a thread through everything. Thank you.
That was useful in terms of exploring implementation. I don't think I have time to go into aquaculture, convener, so I'll leave that to you.
Well, there's an assumption. Claire, did you want to say anything?
I just want to say I don't particularly have any knowledge of fisheries. That's not my area of expertise. But as far as sort of regeneration and restoration goes, I think there's a real lack of attention to additional pressures. We're looking at sort of, it tends to look at degenerated areas, and there seems to be an assumption that regenerating it will be it, will suffice. But, you know, you've got constant increases in chemical and plastic pollution coming in, so we really need to be looking at the wider picture of that, especially the sort of whole source to sea network. I appreciate today we're just looking at the marine aspect of this, but I do welcome the fact that the plan does talk about that to a certain extent, and it refers to Nature Scots' source to sea document as well. So I think that was really my main point.
Yeah. Okay.
Change is a factor there as well.
Absolutely, sorry, yes, climate change is a factor.
Wider ecological
as well.
Health of our oceans. Yeah. Yeah. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. I think you've got a couple of questions.
I do. I'll pick up on funding and investment resources have been mentioned a bit already. But before I do, I was quite concerned to hear Mr. Tavish Scott say that it's a struggle to keep up with government invitations, attend meetings and to respond to consultations. I think that's something that, you know, we'll reflect on. I'm sure government will too. And I think it's important that all stakeholders do have capacity. But what's even more worrying for me today is that the broadcaster and RSPCA president, Chris Packham, made quite a big intervention yesterday and has called for, in his words, the halt of catastrophic expansion of Scottish salmon farms, saying that a moratorium is needed. as mortality rates jump. Now, I know we've heard today a lot about the importance of data and evidence, so I'm keen to get a better understanding. But we're reading in the press that salmon mortality in Scotland has hit record levels this year, which is catastrophic for fish welfare and Scotland's environment. So I wonder, Mr Scott, is Chris Packham wrong or does he have a point?
Well, Mr Packham is a well-known opponent of our sector and has been for a long time, and he's trotted out his usual arguments. We've invited him many times, Ms Lennon, to visit our farms and to meet any of our people and to discuss any of the issues he has, and he's never taken us up on that opportunity. And if you wish to come, I extend the opportunity, the invitation here in front of the convener this morning. So please don't necessarily read The Guardian, but come and actually listen to fish farmers themselves, and they'll describe exactly what they do, and they'll answer all your questions that you'd wish to pose in this area. Is mortality an issue? Yes, it is. Are we needing to tackle it in an ever greater way? Yes, we are. Are we determined to do that? Absolutely. And millions of pounds of investment is going into that. The fundamentals to mortality this year and last year have been warmer seas. We've had an El Nino effect in terms of how we've had to confront the challenges in our marine environment, and much has been learnt over the last year. We are an evidence and data-based sector. That's the only way we can successfully develop our businesses, and to that extent, that is why we spent so much time working with scientists, oceanographers and others to ensure we understand what is happening. But the most fundamental issue is we have seen different types of microorganism in the marine environment over the last couple of years, which frankly haven't been seen for a decade or more in our waters. And our ability then as fish farmers is to deal with that, to find ways to manage that and to put in the correct mitigations, and that's what we are determined to do. So you raise a perfectly fair point in a fair way. I would just suggest that sometimes others do not.
Mm. Are you taking that up with The Guardian?
Not at all. I leave The Guardian to write whatever it wishes, but I just read it carefully.
Okay. Well, I'm sure we've not heard the last of that because serious issues have been raised. We won't get to the bottom of it today. But we have heard many calls for better regulation, for better enforcement. So that brings me back to the point about resources. In written submissions, many stakeholders have raised concerns about this strategy. We've also heard about a big reduction in the budget for bodies like Nature Scots. So I wonder if I can maybe start with Dr. Claire Cavers and work along the table. Do you have concerns about the resourcing of this strategy, which I like to think of as not just a biodiversity strategy, but it's about Scotland's nature emergency? Where will the funding come from, or what does the funding need to look like for this to work effectively?
I don't think I have the solution to where the funding will come from.
Perhaps an unfair question ahead of the budget.
Yeah, slightly. I think there definitely needs to be more funding. I think we can maybe look to what happens in other nations where industry supplies some of that funding. As you know, we don't oppose industry. We, as an organisation, we work with industry to try and make sure they have minimal impact on the environment. So we totally accept that industry has to be there, but industry also has to, first of all, be aware of its limits and its impacts and work to mitigate those impacts. And part of that is extended producer responsibility, and part of that is potentially funding mitigating actions. And going back to the point you had before about aquaculture, I think the industry itself admits that it has challenges that it needs to address, but at the same time it's still wanting to expand. Mm-hmm. And our view is that it should be addressing its challenges and then expanding. That seems to make a bit more sense. Otherwise, you just seem to be firefighting constantly along the way.
So on that point, then, you tend to be agreeing more with Mr Packham, who's calling for a moratorium until we look at this issue with mortality rates.
I think to a certain extent, yes. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't necessarily mean stifling the industry. I think the industry... as Tavish said, they are very aware of the challenges they're facing. The thing is, they've known about these challenges for a while, and there doesn't seem to be a real acknowledgement of the fact that climate change is happening and needs mm-hmm. to be dealt with. It tends to be used as an excuse. So we've had high mortalities this year because of climate change. there doesn't really seem to be an acknowledgement that because the climate is changing, perhaps we should be moving our farms, perhaps we should be doing things slightly differently. So there is action, there is innovation happening, but I think potentially legislation and regulation could support that and push that a little bit. I think the CEPA's sea lice risk assessment framework is doing that to a certain extent, but these things have been a long time coming.
OK, well, perhaps panel members can respond to that. But before we move on, one of the points made in your written submission was that the biodiversity impact screening, there should be biodiversity impact screening for any recipient of public funds, including in their supply chain. Could you just briefly say why you think that's important?
I think that goes to sort of producer responsibility. Okay. You know, I think everything, every industry is going to have an impact on the environment in some way. That is that's not avoidable. You can't say any road is not going to impact the environment, for example, that then accesses a site. But that should be assessed, and the biodiversity impact should be part of that.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Callum.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, absolutely, on the funding, that's a concern. We wrote to Deputy First Minister highlighting the 40% real terms cut for Nature Scot, 26% real terms cut for CEPA. So that is a concern. I suppose mainstreaming biodiversity would also include recognising that improved nature helps well-being as well. So it might be, you know, innovative ways to use other budgets as well. The Scottish Marine Environment Enhancement Fund is a welcome fund that is helping to resource projects quite often for actively restoring nature, including seagrass beds and native oyster beds, and support what my colleague to my left, Elspeth, had said on that. We support oyster restoration and are involved with projects on that, but it's a drop in the ocean, so we need more of the industries that benefit from a healthy environment contributing to that pot and helping to be even better local stewards to improve nature where they operate. And we're very proud to be part of the Dornoch Environment Enhancement Project, where the Glenmorangie Whisky Company has demonstrated leadership there, I think, in sort of recognising they're a local steward of the Dornoch and they want to go further than compliance. So so more industries that benefit from the sea contributing to the SMEF fund that can help support community aspiration for restoration around our coast. And I won't add to what Claire said about
that's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Elspeth.
Yeah, a short answer to your question, you know, are we concerned about resources to deliver this? Yes, absolutely. I think, be in no doubt, that what is set out in the delivery plan is a very resource-intensive set of proposals. And I come back to my point I made earlier about that's why I think it's really important that very careful thought is given to what are the right things to do in what order, and that the resources are targeted at the right things in the right way. I think we have a concern, and I think several of us have touched on it already. Marine Directorate, part of the Scottish Government, have been working on a new science strategy. We're yet to see that, but I fully expect that that is going to be stretched increasingly. The resources that it will have to deliver that are going to be stretched increasingly across a very broad range of areas, all the things we've been talking about today, all the other responsibilities that they have. So, yeah, I have real concerns about the resources to deliver. And I think it's important as well, we don't just think about resources in terms of money, but also we think about resources in terms of skills.
Yeah.
To deliver this in the marine environment requires a very extensive range of scientific, economic, all sorts of professional skill sets. And I think we have to make sure that the investment that government and society makes in education and how we train people, how we retain and have the right skill sets in Scotland to actually help us deliver these ambitions is all part of the mix. It isn't just about money, it's also about having the right people with the right skills to do these things.
And I think one of the suggestions we got in our written submissions was that the Marine Directorate should undertake a strategic review, if I can read my own handwriting, of its enforcement assets, so looking at equipment as well. And I think the point being made was that we need to have effective deterrent of illegal activities. Is there a concern about equipment? Do we have...
Well, I think increasingly enforcement bodies, they increasingly, I think, across different sectors, not just ours, use intelligence-led approaches, so they can't be out there looking at everybody all the time. So use intelligence to identify where there may be problems and then target the resources you've got on these problems. As we've talked about in the marine environment, obviously everything is a bit different because you're you can't see under the sea particularly easily. The compliance part of Marine Directorate have vessels, they have access to aerial surveillance. They'll have use of data from different sources. So I think again, it's about looking at the skill set that you need, the information that you need, and how are you best resourced to deliver that.
Okay, thank you, Tavish.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, can I just gently push back on the suggestion that we haven't, as a sector, embraced the challenge of climate change? That's why we have a sustainability charter. That's why we're committed to net zero by 2045, in line with your aspirations as a parliament and as the government as well. So I don't accept the remark that was made by one of your witnesses earlier on. Just on regulation, Ms. Anne, you ask a really good question. We pay for all our regulation, so it's full cost recovery, and I accept that. That's as it should be. Business should pay the costs of regulation, so we pay all our CPA charges, all our local planning charges, and other regulators who we take a service from. Our argument is not for less regulation. Our argument is for better, more streamlined regulation. That's why Professor Russell Griggs reported to the Cabinet Secretary a year and a half ago on exactly that, and we applaud that direction of travel. So our fear is never for more regulation, because regulation can be an asset for business. Good regulation allows business to sell its product into marketplace with confidence because it is properly regulated. So I absolutely accept the role of good regulation in Scotland. And to be clear, we in Scotland are more regulated than any other salmon sector anywhere else around the world. So I don't want you to go away from today thinking either we're not regulated at all or it's light regulation. The reverse is the opposite of the case. But to be absolutely crystal clear on your very fair point about resources, we pay for our regulation.
Phil.
Thank you very much. So I agree with the point made by many that a lot of this, the delivery plan will require additional action or action that will require costs and that the government bodies that are responsible for some of it are slim on resources. I think that there's an opportunity here to use some of the funds that are in existence. Callum's mentioned SMEEF, which is one of the world's worst acronyms. But there's also the Nature Recovery Fund and there's the Marine Fund Scotland to better incentivise and drive change than is currently being done. So Marine Fund Scotland, you know, last year paid a huge amount of money to put solar panels on a fish processors in Peterhead and bought boats within fleets that are arguably over capacity. So adding to the problems rather than addressing them and driving some of that change. I think with Nature Recovery Fund, what would need to be done is for there to be a slight adaptation as to what the remit of that fund is allowed to fund at the moment, because my understanding, albeit somewhat limited, is that actually that fund, you know, a lot of what we need to do to restore the marine environment is actually better regulate impact rather than take initial steps, you know, like progressive additional steps. There's additional steps, great projects like the seagrass restoration, oyster restoration, but those aren't going to address the overarching problem, which is that we've still got a declining health out with that sort of very near shore area. And so if we can, one thing I would like to suggest is that there be some kind of thought about how that those funds can be used to better incentivise change. Mr. Lenyard spoke about compliance. The key aspect of compliance agreed by everybody, including Marine Scotland's science teams, is remote electronic monitoring. So this is monitoring of what's caught where. And that will also then feed right into the understanding of where those nursery grounds are, those juvenile grounds are. It's a bit of a cost. It's not massive cost, but it's a bit of a cost, and it's a bit of a cost that will currently come on businesses. And there's clearly an opportunity here to ensure that some of these funds, which are already, you know, committed to, the spend already there in budget, so you're not needing to go back out to finance ministers and ask for brand new pots of money, but to adapt and sort of open up those funds so that they can be made more relevant to what is in effect marine nature restoration, responding to the nature emergency. And the final point I'd like to make is we've spoken a lot about delay and a lot about consultation and a lot about things. that have not been delivered, that have been said to be delivered. Every year these delays happen, more money is spent on that project. So, you know, it feels like there's a bottleneck of all these policies coming together at one point. But a lot of that is simply policies that were due to be delivered a long time ago that are just getting shunted and shunted and shunted. And if we end up getting toward 2030 and we haven't delivered our biodiversity nature emergency plan, we're going to have 20, 30, 40, 50 policies that need to be implemented in Awana. There's going to be huge stress on government and officials, and is therefore going to cost government and officials a lot more money. So get on and deliver those commitments that have already been made, and that is in itself a cost-saving exercise.
Thank you. I'll hand back to the convener, because I'm conscious of time.
Thank you very much, Monica.
To myself
that's
for now.
Kind. I'm going to just move to the two members who've joined the committee for the day. Then I'm going to... Would you like to come in now, or would you like to come in after them?
Sorry, convener.
Whatever suits you, Deputy Convener. I don't want to upset you.
If I may, just a quick question, sorry. It was just in relation to points that Dr. Cavers raised earlier, and also relate to Mr. Duncan as well. When I do beach cleans not too far from here in my constituency at Wardy Bay, for example, the prevailing issue over and above human litter and pollution is nurdles. And Dr. Cavers, you mentioned the plastic pellet prevalence on the beaches of South Queensferry as well, similarly. So I just wondered, in terms of our considerations today, but also if relevant considerations to do with the Circular Economy Bill, if there's anything further that either of you would like to add about the issue of plastic pellet pollution, otherwise known as nurdles, what the situation is and what can and should we do about it?
Definitely can answer that, and thank you very much for the opportunity. I think there, as we sort of touched on before, there is no organisation that is directly responsible for dealing with that, and we saw gaps happen in with the aquaculture regulation, with wild salmon, with that, and it's the same at the moment with nurdle pollution in Scotland. In England, for example, the Environment Agency has approached companies that it's identified as being sources of plastic pellet pollution. There is no responsibility for doing that with any organisation in Scotland at the moment, and there isn't a mechanism for that to be put in place. And that could apply to all sorts of sources of plastic and chemical pollution. So I think that is one of the main things to do moving forward, is attribute responsibility for that to an organisation for monitoring and then for regulation as well.
Anything further, Mr. Noel?
Yeah, first, thank you for helping out at Wardy. There's a great community there, and they're to be commended for all the hard work they do.
Absolutely.
I would just say, the Circular Economy Bill is really important for us. We need the economy to be circular so plastic doesn't leak in the ocean. So that runs through everything that we're doing, and I would endorse everything Dr. Cavers has said. What I would say is that any policy or law or strategy that's implemented, you know, has to bear in mind and enact the principle that Dr. Cavers mentioned, which is now in the Continuity Scotland Act, which is that environmental damage should be rectified at source. So if we're turning off the tap at source, these items aren't getting in the sea. If nurdles are getting in the sea, the people that are making them are not handling them properly. I've been involved with that for a couple of decades. I was finding them in Cramond 20 years ago. We had tours of places that make them. You know, if they're still getting in the sea and they're fresh, it's not working. And so ask the people that are making them.
Thank you for that feedback and information. Do either of you see the Circular Economy Bill as a possibility to make a difference in this regard?
Definitely.
Perhaps Dr. Cavers first.
Yes, yeah, sorry. Definitely. We really welcome the Circular Economy Bill. We do advise caution around the circular economy, because there is a tendency to just focus on recycling in the sort of physical sense, where you really have to be aware of chemicals, and if you're recycling products and materials with has this chemicals in, then you're just keeping them in circulation. So we really need sort of robust chemical regulation to go alongside our sort of recycling, and that applies to things like compostable substances as well.
But in terms of plastic pellets, is there anything specific more that we can and should do legislatively, or is the government
I think
required to act here in other ways?
Sorry,
carry on.
There's strong legislation coming out of Europe at the moment, and I think Scotland has ambitions to mirror that. So they have got quite good microplastics legislation that has been passed recently, and I think it's going in the right direction. And we welcome, as I said before, seeing the reference to plastic pellets in the biodiversity strategy. I think the bearing in mind the impacts on sort of SMEs as well is something that probably comes under the sort of socio-economic consideration we had before, and support for moving into some of these systems. So you need to ensure that if we're asking businesses to change practices, to ensure that there's a just transition processes in place to help them make those changes.
Thank you. Very briefly, Mr. Duncan.
Yeah, I'm happy to come back to you on that.
If you could write to the committee, that would be helpful.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ben.
Mark, you want to come in? I'm just going to say that unfortunately Phil Taylor's had to leave for another appointment, so there is an empty chair there. He's not being empty chaired. He's had to leave. So, Mark, with your question.
We haven't chased it all. I just want to go back to that point, actually, that Deputy Convener raised around just transition, because we spend a lot of time as committee thinking about what a just transition looks like for the energy sector. We've considered how a just transition is embedded into the Climate Act as well. Do you see those kind of principles as being important for embedding in this approach? And I'm thinking about, you know, perhaps if I can ask our sector representatives, if there was, say, a transition in the inshore away from scallop dredging, other economic opportunities might arise out of that. Is it important that there's a just transition approach applied to that? Or with salmon farming, for example, maybe in the future there might be retirement of open pen salmon farms, if you can imagine that, towards other technologies. How do you take workers, how do you take sectors with you?
I was interested in this word that you politicians use about just. You need to explain that to 12,000 people who work in our sector, Mr. Ruskell. How just would that be on their futures? We employ people in lots of parts of Scotland who wouldn't have a job at an average salary of £36,000. I'm very proud of that, very proud of that, where there isn't much employment. I can go all the way up the West Coast to the islands I live in and everywhere else. And you, with respect, kind of say in broad terms, you could close down open net farming. That will close the industry down in Scotland. Be really clear about that. What you've just suggested is closing the industry down in Scotland. And you'll forgive me, but I'm not going to agree with you on that. A, the technology isn't there. B, it hasn't worked at scale anywhere in the world. And C, the science, data and evidence isn't there. And fourthly, the energy costs of what you've just suggested, which is onshore farming, are enormous. So when those of you who make that kind of argument think about it, you need to also think about the other side of the equation, not just the one that you've possibly been pitched to by those who make that case.
You're perhaps sort of jumping on that as one potential way forward. I think the whole point of just transition is that it's led by workers, it's led by people within those sectors, so they're coming up with the solutions, be it sea lice, be it biodiversity impact, and they're using their technical innovation to do that. Now, I don't know what the solutions are for your sector. I don't work in that area. But is there something about the principle of saying, okay, we've got strict biodiversity targets, we've got the need to move forward. How do we involve sectors in that change? How do you actually deliver the change, which I think you acknowledge needs to happen? And the same with fisheries as well, same with the energy sector, How is this driven by sectors themselves in a way which is just, rather than just saying we don't want the change?
We've enormously changed in the last 10 years, the last 20, last 30 years, Mr. Ruskell. I'm not going to accept that we sit in ASPEC and nothing changes. Our industry, from the industry I knew in Shetland in the 1980s, is chalk and cheese to where we are today. And I'm, again, very, very proud of that. The difference is enormous. And you're very welcome any time to come and visit us and see that change. I'm always disappointed that some parliamentarians don't take up our invitation in that way, to come and actually learn and listen and talk to people. Don't need to take my word for it. Come and talk to scientists and people who run these businesses and come and see for yourselves. But you make a good point. If the Scottish Government would give us the regulatory ability to innovate and trial in, for example, deeper water areas, then we could, you're onto something. But the regulatory restrictions, so someone earlier mentioned we could just simply move to other sites. We can only do that with regulatory approval. So if, as happens in Norway, there is a regulatory system that encourages innovation and allows us, I don't ask you to invest in it, we would make the investment. I'm not asking the public sector to do that. We would make the investment. But to do that and to trial some of the innovations that we'd like to do, we need to have the regulatory approval to do that. And that's, I would simply suggest, the gap at the moment.
Elspeth, I don't know if you want to react to my comment. I should say, actually, I did speak to a Scarlett Dredger a number of years ago who was interested in making a transition away.
I wouldn't
want to suggest what into, so...
No. Well, I think what's really important to remember is that the fishing industry, like the salmon farming industry, is very innovative and is always looking how to move forward. What can we do better? What can we do differently? How can we reduce our emissions? How can we reduce our impact? There's work ongoing at the moment, for example, in universities in Scotland, looking at different types of gear for catching scallops that will have less impact. So I think that the people in the industry are always looking forward, are always looking for better ways to do things more efficiently, to do things with, that will lessen their impact. I could. We have a vessel in the fleet, in the prawn fleet in Fraserburgh, new vessel just launched earlier this year. The business that runs this vessel invested, spent more money to make modifications in the design and the propulsion of that vessel, that it burns less fuel, it has lower emissions. Despite the fact that it has cost them more to make those, they see that as the way forward. That they're showing leadership in the industry, and others will follow that lead, I fully expect, because they can see the benefits that that will bring. I think what we must never lose sight of in all of this, both in Tavish's industry and in mine, is that we are producing food. Mm. So. There's a growing demand for seafood globally. We have a growing population. Seafood plays a critically important part in feeding not just people in Scotland, but people around the world. And if you reduce or limit or constrain how much food we can sustainably produce from the sea, that food will have to be produced from somewhere else. Quite likely with higher impacts. Seafood compares extremely favourably in terms of its environmental impacts, its carbon impacts compared to other foodstuffs. So I think suggesting that there might be a sort of transition away from food production, and I know that's not exactly what you were suggesting, but a just transition for the oil and gas industry, for example, is a very, very different proposition to a just transition in relation to food production.
Yeah, thanks for those reflections.
Tight on time, and I'd like to give both Finn and Rhoda two questions each, but not to every member of the panel, just to be clear, Mr. Carson.
Convener, firstly, I probably should declare an interest as being the species champion for the native oyster bed. I'm in the unique position of a species champion who can actually eat the species that he's trying to protect, and I enjoy the odd one, I must admit. I think what we've heard this morning is that there's certainly, we've heard about crowded seas, we've heard about marine spatial squeeze. I think what we're seeing now is a policy squeeze with crowded ministerial responsibilities, and I think that's one of the reasons I'm here today, is because there's still this fluffy idea of actually who takes responsibility. We've discussed marine issues in our committee, particularly around the lack of fit-for-purpose data, just how much is actually collected properly and how much is modelled. That is a concern. We clearly saw from the Bute House Agreement-driven Clyde cod box debacle that an embarrassing situation where we had Marine Scotland officers trying to defend adequate data to change policy, that there's issues there. But from the rural affairs point of view, we understand that creating a biodiversity positive marine environment is of critical importance. We can't forget the socio-economic impact of our policies. That is equally important. So arguments are often made without actually touching on the positive or negative aspects of socio and economic impact, because it sometimes just doesn't fit the narrative of those groups or organisations that are trying to promote a particular point of view. But in agriculture, we have rural land use partnerships who bring all the stakeholders together and are supposed to look at landscape scale policies and the impact that has right across. I was surprised there was nobody touched on regional inshore fisheries groups, which are supposed to be the group where fishermen and stakeholders can actually input and comment on policies. Does that suggest the government are not serious about really engaging with the fishing industry through these sort of regional inshore groups? Because as far as I can see, they're inadequately funded and not really fit for purpose. So can I have your comments on whether specifically regional inshore fisheries group have got a role in ensuring that we can have a biodiversity plan that actually works for biodiversity and for fishing communities?
Come in first on that one. I mean, I think the regional inshore fishery groups are a good idea, but yes, I think they are they're not particularly well resourced, I think, to get greatest value from them. You know, their purpose should be for to be able to really engage with people at the sort of sharp end of the industry. Actually, those involved, those impacted by policies, those who, as Mr. Ruskell has just suggested, may indeed have good ideas and good suggestions, and actually ways in which the industry can bring ideas to the government's table. So. The Scottish Government has just, I think, in the last year or so rearranged the inshore fishery groups a little and have appointed a new set of chairs to, I think there's six of them now, and their intention is, I think, to review their effectiveness at some point next year. But I think they could work a lot better, and I think there's real opportunity there, but they would need to be resourced. And the important thing, too, is I think, certainly from my members' perspective and from industry's perspective, they have to see value. They have to see a purpose in them attending these things. They have to see some benefit, some change, something that is actually being delivered, because these are busy folk, particularly in the inshore fleet. They're often running very small businesses. They don't have a lot of spare time to go along and just be in a talking shop. So it has to be something that is meaningful and will deliver something.
I'm going to bring Callum in, and then I'm going to push you for your second question. You gave quite a long statement, but Callum.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for championing the native oyster as well. the inshore fisheries groups are important. It's absolutely critical that local fishers have a voice and a forum to formulate what they would like to see as policy and management. My concern in Scotland, as I think I've raised in the Environment Committee as well, is how the inshore fisheries management integrates with other activities in the inshore, because we still don't have our regional marine plans. And I've seen this play out in real time, representing Link on the Clyde Marine Planning Partnership, for example. And it's quite challenging to get integration. So we do look with a certain amount of envy to the inshore fisheries and conservation authorities in England, where they've got regional statutory bodies where conservation and fisheries management are integrated. And I think a lot of the challenges, particularly in the inshore in Scotland, arise because there isn't that integration. You've got conversations happening about the same sea space in different forums. So IFGs do have a role, the inshore governance needs to be improved to better integrate the fisheries management with the conservation, and also to hear other voices as well, because the IFCAs have boards and other stakeholders are on those boards as well, as I've submitted in previous evidence as well.
Okay, thank you. The delivery plan doesn't appear to be costly. You've touched on an equivalent of financial memorandum, but it's very ambitious. It's a bit like the agricultural bill that we're looking at. Very ambitious. No boundaries to it. Don't know how much it's going to cost. Do we need to be more pragmatic going forward? Ambition is good, but if you can't deliver on your ambitions, you know, targets that can't possibly be met, you know, there's an argument about climate change, targets were far too ambitious and we need to be more pragmatic. Does this plan need to be more pragmatic, but still to be actually effectively deliver?
Because Elspeth did the last one, and then probably Claire, if you want to come in on that.
So very briefly, I think Mr. Carson makes a really good point. Business would like clarity, and clarity comes with good definitions and good targets. I mean, fairness to Phil, he mentioned smart targets. I entirely endorse that. I think that's the right thing to do, and I hope Parliament will very fully scrutinise what the nature of exactly that. But I remember back in the day, you know, ministers not hitting climate change targets that were statutory. I don't remember anyone losing a job over it. So I think Parliament will want to take a view about, so what? Now, if it's to mean something and Parliament want business to go with it, then the points that Elspeth and I have been seeking to forward about really good regulatory assessments, I think, are really important. We'll go with it as long as you show show the benefits of it. We'll be absolutely with you all the way on that. But, yeah, I'd be for making it real to people, because I think that actually makes, if I may say so, my other colleagues' jobs easier, if we can absolutely understand what we're all trying to achieve. And at the moment, it seems all up there.
I fully agree with everyone that's talked about smart targets today as well. I think more definitive timelines and responsibilities, if you're attributing responsibility to organisations and sectors, then you're going to hold people accountable and they will have their targets that they have to meet. And they're presumably, if they don't meet their targets, they have consequences that come back to them as well.
Thank you. Oda.
My questions are around the same theme, so I won't make any kind of introduction to them. I was interested about the lack of a social and economic impact, and I think we're all committed to a just transition. Can you have one without the other? If you don't know the impact of what you're doing, how can you transition?
Convenient, that's helpful. I don't really have a lot to add, because I think we've probably done that one to death, but I think Ms. Grant makes a really good...
A yes or no answer.
Yes.
I agree,
but I would emphasise what Phil had said, that a lot of the policies in there have an SEIA process as well, so it's not that it wouldn't be part of the process.
And Claire?
Yeah, I agree, of course, but there are also actions such as pollution prevention and monitoring that don't necessarily have a social economic impact directly, and we could be doing more of that.
Rhoda.
Okay, thank you. We seem to have focused on fishing and fish farming today, but there is a lot more going on in the marine environment, and we hear more about a squeeze on fishing, but also things like offshore energy and the like. Should we be looking at that? Listen, I'm now asking two questions in one, sorry.
You'll only get one answer.
and also, we've heard about how complex this consultation is. And how do we engage stakeholders? Because what went really wrong with the HPMA process was it was top-down, it was imposing things that people largely didn't understand or know about enough about, because it was just a huge lump of policy that nobody actually disaggregated and spoke to people about the impact on them. How do we avoid that? Because this seems just the same. It's like a big top-down exercise, not involving the people that it's going to impact. And I just fear it's going to get the same reaction, given there is a huge amount of distrust out there.
Tavish.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, to the first question. I think Elspeth and I would very happily discuss marine spatial squeeze and Parliament's interest in that. I think it has to be local to do it effectively. So the Clyde or areas seem to me, so it kind of links to Mr. Carson's point about what is the right structure in order to achieve that objective. But absolutely, there need to be those discussions. We're working, for example, with kelp businesses now. There's a growing seaweed industry in Scotland. We very much welcome that. There's lots of, and this is maybe a bit of a challenge for some of Elspeth's colleagues in the inshore sector, and I would accept that and recognise that point, but a huge potential for us in the biodiversity space of working with kelp businesses, very compatible with salmon farming. So I think there are good things that happen in that space, but it is a complex discussion, and to find the right forum, I think it just has to be local. You can't do these things at a national level. They've got to be structured in a way which allows the local players to be involved in that and to make as effective good decisions, again based on good science and data, which I'm afraid drags us right back to the point that Mr. Carson and others were highlighting about the investment by government and indeed industry in science. That's where we can all coalesce to help us make sensible decisions.
Callum, just to get if do you agree?
No, absolutely. I think having conversations with people in the room, local people, getting their knowledge, having those discussions is absolutely fundamental. I think there's a lot of information that can inform those discussions, and I think once it's there and people are looking at maps, people can have respectful agreements and disagreements, but at least if they all know what the purpose is, those discussions can be convivial and productive. But again, it's an investment of time and resource to be able to do that effectively, and I know that there's some successful work's been done on that in relation to deer management and the common ground work there, and people with quite different views coming together. So we absolutely support that. That's also why we support regional marine planning and integration of fisheries management with regional marine planning. But that's delayed as well. So we do need to have those spaces to have those conversations. And the local stakeholders know their environment. We absolutely respect that.
Okay. I'm afraid, Red, we're on our time limit. But can I just say that I'm going to ask a final question, which is a yes-no answer and one sentence, and you'll all get a chance to do it. So my problem is that what I've heard this morning is there needs to be a balance between nature, environment and jobs, and that's absolutely critical. But we have some dichotomies. So, for example, when it comes to electrofishing for razor clams, are there unseen effects on other species? Do we know what that truly means? When it comes to dredging, are there habitat destruction and is there a huge length of time to recover? With agriculture, I'm not going to pass comment except I think the REC report was absent in 2018 and remains absent today, but there are conflicts potentially there between wild salmon and other crustaceans. When it comes to renewables, it may affect demersal fisheries, may affect chopping up seabirds who are suffering from avian flu at the moment. And should we be taking steps to stop the sand eel fishery to make sure they've got enough food? And when it comes to plastic waste, the damage it does to all our flora and fauna. We all want to be good neighbours, but we're all competing for the same space. So is it possible to be good neighbours and develop everything the government wants, yes or no? And what's the one thing that you need to do, each of you, to make sure that happens? So, Tavish, do you want to start off with that?
Yes, it is possible to be good neighbours. I absolutely agree with you, Convener, on that. And what is the one thing the sector needs to do? Continue to invest in science. I forgive me for being boring on this, but I can't emphasise enough how much we depend as a sector on science, and I believe that government needs that too. So that's probably, if you're going to give me one thing, that would be the one thing.
Long sentence, Elspeth.
Yes, I think we can be good neighbours. Whether we can deliver all that government wants remains to be seen. But I think one of the challenges to that, and something that we all need to do better, is we actually, I think, need to educate people better about the complexity of what we're trying to do. These things are really... This is a very long sentence, I apologise. But educating people in general about the fact that these are not simple things to fix. These are really complex issues and they can't be fixed by simple slogans and simple solutions.
Callum.
Yes, and by making the case better for why protecting and recovering nature is good for people, and to continue and increase the conversations around all this policy area and how it interacts and helps benefit. Good nature benefits local people.
Claire.
Yes, I really agree with that as well. You may have industries, but industries involve people and people have lives and they have lifestyles. I think between industry and people, between different sectors, such as all ourselves. We want to see better potentially collaboration and compromise and transparency.
Okay, so I'm walking away with four yeses, which is probably as positive as I can get. Thank you very much for sharing your expertise with us this morning. On the 9th of January, we're going to be taking evidence from a panel of experts on terrestrial biodiversity. We will then write a letter to the Scottish Government to input our views on the draft plan before it's finalised. And we look forward to sharing that with you. Thank you very much, and we are now going to move into private session.